Hello, and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where it seems that Tom Cruise doesn't just do amazing feats on screen, but at the box office as well. Yes, thanks to stellar word of mouth and absolutely no competition. Side note, you know that tentpole that usually kicks off August? Well, because Mission Impossible Fallout took all the IMAX screens, the late July release is the final tentpole of the summer and really has to only worry about the Meg, maybe, until another Warner Brothers movie hits, actually. It's nice to see Warner Brothers on a bit of a winning streak coming off of Comic-Con, right? But they have The Nun also hitting September 7th. Maybe Mile 22, maybe Mile 22 could be something. I'm rooting for Iko Uwais, but the industry doesn't have particularly high expectations. Anyway, back to Mission Impossible Fallout. The second weekend saw just a 43% drop, which is not only a franchise best, but an incredibly impressive hold for a blockbuster film, where even the biggest hits drop in the high 50s in their second weekends. Now, of course, it helps when you don't open that big, right? You get a little bit of a smaller drop as a result. But still, bottom line, Mission Impossible Fallout is already past 300 million globally in just 2 weeks, with many countries, including China, still to go. And at this rate, Mission Impossible Fallout is pacing to not only be the first Mission Impossible movie to make it into the 700s, but get this, 800s isn't out of the question. Oh boy! Either way, not adjusted for inflation. That would make Mission Impossible Fallout the biggest film of Cruise's career. Not bad for someone who's been a household name, not just started working, was a household name since the early 80s and almost imploded his career in 2005. Keep that in mind, people who are currently having some problems. It was a long road back, right? But if you're freakishly disciplined and optimistic, as Tom Cruise is known to be, that's kind of his trademark even, well then, you can do it. Now, speaking of amazing feats, Black Panther, which apparently is still playing in theaters, passed 700 million over the weekend just domestically. Only the third film ever to do so after The Force Awakens and Avatar, which are now all Disney movies. Black Panther is also the only film in the worldwide top 10 of all time to get more than 50% of its box office from the domestic market, the United States. So bring on Storm for the sequel, a proper storm, and watch it rain even more. But it's a little dry right now in the 100 Acre Wood, where Christopher Robin opened on par with smaller family films like Peter Rabbit and the recent Pete's Dragon remake. Now, to be fair, Peter Rabbit managed to cross the century mark eventually and make a domestic and make a whopping 350 million worldwide, thanks to solid business in the UK, naturally, being a UK property, and China. But while Christopher Robin opens in its native UK August 17th, and in fact has most of the globe still to go, it will never open in China, which made for a very interesting headline over the weekend, because the reason it'll never open in China is because the country has banned all Winnie the Pooh imagery, as the little guy has become a symbol of the resistance to the resistance against the ruling Communist Party. You can't make this stuff up. It's as if Yoda was the symbol of the rebellion in Star Wars. It's crazy. Now, this crackdown against Winnie the Pooh only began last year, just as Christopher Robin began filming, or else you can imagine that Disney probably wouldn't have gone forward with this project. But speaking of business decisions, Disney had to know early on they were making non-commercial creative choices for Christopher Robin. Even Ewan McGregor is not a big box office draw. I mean, he doesn't hurt the box office, but people don't pay to see Ewan McGregor. I don't know why, he's fabulous, but I guess you can put him in the same category as Ryan Gosling. And so surely Disney didn't expect boffo ticket sales. But still, they didn't even do their usual ad blitz for the movie, which is a shame because those that did turn up gave the film an A cinema score. Although maybe because they didn't advertise it, only hardcore fans did show up. up. So we'll see how this eventually shakes out. Because as I said in my review, the title will likely be red hot on streaming and perhaps belong there all along. Make a Christopher Robin streaming show, Disney. It's so obvious. Some of you said that they can't maybe afford to do the VFX for a streaming service, but they're planning to spend like $100 million on a Star Wars show. Why don't you spend just $80 million on that show and $20 million on the TV series? I think it's doable. I think it would be very, very popular. All right, so speaking of streaming, it seems The Spy Who Dumped Me will have to hope to find an audience there as well, with the Mila Kunis comedy opening well below Bad Moms, which itself saw a huge decline for its own sequel. Audiences didn't love this one quite as much as Pooh, though, getting just a B cinema score, and so it would seem that Kunis, and likely Kate McKinnon, simply aren't big screen talent. In contrast, star power earned Ocean's 8 a B-plus cinema score, a slightly better Rotten Tomatoes score, and way better box office. I would say, personally, that The Spy Who Dumped Me is a better film than Ocean's 8, but again, look what star power, a whole plethora of star power, can do. Then as for the weekend's other new release, Jennifer U. Nelson became the latest animation director to fall flat on her face trying to transition to live action. Ooh, it's a rough road to traverse. I don't think actually anyone has successfully done it. Challenge, the gauntlet has been laid down, animation directors. Although if Brad Bird can't do it. I mean, I know a lot of you say that Ghost Protocol, I think, had problems story-wise. Brad Bird admitted over the weekend that Christopher McQuarrie did a lot of uncredited work on the movie. And then, of course, there was Tomorrowland. Oh, I think a lot of people have forgotten about Tomorrowland, which is actually to their benefit. But also, back to the Darkest Minds, this also isn't a good sign for Amanda Stenberg, who's supposed to have a devoted fan base. If I were Fox, I'd be like, what the hell? Where was her fan base? Because I'm sure that's how her management pitched her. They're like, oh, Amanda Stenberg has untapped fans that are going to go out and see her no matter what she's in. And that proved to be incorrect. Now, as for the rest, I mean, that's the name of the game these days. That's why, even though it seems to be against their best interests, all talent needs to have social media accounts. Now, as for the rest of the top 10, the biggest drop was Teen Titans Go, which in only its second weekend almost fell out of the top 10. Time to drown their sorrows in some pie. And I'm sure a Nails on a Chalkboard song. Some people like the movie, but I think they all went first weekend. Again, another title that probably belonged on streaming to begin with. Now, the best hold in the top 10 was actually Ant-Man and the Wasp, which, here's an update, has reached $426 million worldwide. And now it's just about $90 million behind the very first Ant-Man, and number 18 out of 20 for the MCU overall in terms of box office. Oh, the summer started out so good for Marvel, but it's been kind of going downhill, right? Let's hope that Captain Marvel can course correct. And the fact that this all relies on a huge SJW like Brie Larson, oh, I think that Marvel's roller coaster ride ain't over yet. We'll see. Now, as for this coming weekend, we'll also see if the Meg can chew up and spit out Hollywood's modest projection. While Black Klansman hopes to generate buzz from audiences, because the media ain't talking about it too much, but, you know, Black Klansman would love to be an audience hit and kick off award season a little bit earlier than usual. Not too much earlier. Award season's going to really start in earnest in September with the Toronto Film Festival. And if you would like to check out my early Oscar predictions, there's a link down below in the video description. But Black Klansman, of course, is part of that. I think it's Spike Lee's a little bit of a risk, taking a little bit of a risk here, but it's not a ridiculous risk. And then also Slender Man also sneaks into the marketplace and is expected to do not bad, in fact, showing the strength of the horror genre these days. So that's this week's Movie Math. Thank you for going over the box office with me. I look forward to hearing your thoughts about it down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.